Dear friends and family in Christ, may the light of Christ fill your hearts this day and each day, as you are a child of God. Please bow your heads in prayer with me as we do go to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in prayer. Lord Jesus, we give thanks to you for your birth in Bethlehem, for the joy that it brings to our hearts this day, for the light that fills our lives. Help us each and every day to be not only those who receive your beauteous light, but also to be those who reflect it, that all may see the glory of your salvation that you have poured out to us. Lord, help us each day to live lives of love and service to you, sharing that light to all we believe, all who need to hear your message of salvation, those in our family, those in our communities, those to the ends of the earth. This we pray in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. You know, one of my joys of Christmas, and again, probably for you all, is the opportunity to see the various lights that light up people's houses during this time of year. It gets dark early, so it's easy to go around, and at the very least, Jacob makes sure that we go around our neighborhood. But we don't just usually do that. We'll drive through neighborhoods in El Centro and Imperial, and we'll see lights that that people have decorated their houses with from foundation to peak, from one end of the yard to the other. You see people who have just a few lights, to people who have, well, we have a term for it in our family, I won't say here, but where it just covers their whole yard. Now, it's not just Jacob who likes it, but Carla and I enjoy it as well. And really, we really enjoy the lights, don't we? All of us, almost all of us have, even if we don't have lights on our house, maybe we have lights in our house or lights on our tree. In fact, I think that things have changed quite a bit from the first string of lights. I don't know if you knew this, but Thomas Edison, to amuse his children, and also concerned about the fact that people were putting candles on the tree, in 1880 created the first strand of lights. Now today, the average house puts 3 strands of lights on the outside. Those little bulbs, these little bulbs here, most of them use only 4 deciwatts of power. Now that's not a lot of power until you start to realize how many lights there are. There are millions and millions of lights. And let's put this into perspective. In the Imperial Valley, according to the 2010 census, there was 40,000 homes, single resident homes in the valley. This is the whole Imperial Valley. Now, this doesn't include rental properties. This doesn't include businesses that might also light up their business at this time of year, but 40,000 homes. Now, not everybody lights their homes, so let's say only 20,000 of these homes are lit up for Christmas. So we multiply 20,000, and times each strand is about 40 watts, or like I say, each bulb is 4 deciwatts, and there's about 100 per strand. So if you're following, we have 20,000 times 3 times 100 times 0.4. That's 0.4 watts is what 40 deciwatts is. Okay, to get to the math, in case you couldn't do that in your head, that's 2,400 kilowatts. And that's just here in the Imperial Valley. And that's probably a low number because that doesn't account for those people who are in Brawley, who I've heard that you can light up and you can see from space this one neighborhood in Brawley. And this is not just the rest of the country. When you start to think about it, we put a lot of lights, a lot of power to use this time of year. Power. When you think about it, all that power has to come from somewhere, doesn't it? Great generators that when you get close to them that shake the ground, that are powered by coal and steam and by water and by natural gases. Power. You can just see the magnitude if you were to look at, if you've been to the Hoover Dam, to see the generators producing power. Power. It's not just defined that way, though, is it either? We talk about power. We talk about the President of the United States has power because when he speaks with authority. The country is meant to follow. When our generals take our military, we are known as a force of power throughout the world. We have sway. Some people have power because they have what we might call a silver tongue. They can convince anybody to do anything. Power. It's an interesting concept, especially when we think about the birth of Christ. Isaiah foretold the power of Christ this way. This is Isaiah 40. See, the Lord God comes with power, and his arm rules for him. See, his reward is with him, and his recompense accompanies him. He tends his flock like a shepherd. He gathers the lambs in his arms. He carries them close to his heart. He gently leads those that are young. I like actually the King James a little bit better, because the King James starts out and it says, "Behold, the Lord God comes with strength in his hand." And then he says the ruling with the arm, but the strength in his hand. Not exactly what you picture at Christmas, is it? The Almighty God, the Lord and ruler of the universe, coming down among us in the form of a child. When we peer into the manger, we don't see power. When you think of a baby, you think of helpless and weak and small, frail and fragile. And yet, we keep year after year going to that same manger, don't we? Year after year, we peer again into the manger and we look again. And why do we do that? It's not for the power of this world, for great power that we can imagine, that we can see. But it's power wrapped up in the flesh of a baby. Power to forgive our sins. Isn't that why we peer into the manger? Because we know that we are poor, sinful people. We are people who have not lived lives according to God's word. And we peer into the manger and we see hope. If you think about it, that's not really how God had to come to us, is it? God didn't have to come to us in love and mercy. As he's righteous and he has given us his word, he could have come to us angry as a judge. He could have come to us as ruler of the world, but instead, he comes to us in this small form, wrapped up in swaddling cloths, wrapped up to be salvation of the world. All this power wrapped in grace for us. Not to judge us, not to condemn us, but to forgive us. He came to offer us those words of salvation, those words of love at Christmas, those words, "I love you and forgive each of you." And even if it was just one of us, he would have come. But as we think about that, when we think about that coming to that manger, we see beyond just that child, don't we? We see the child that grew up to a young man, a 12-year-old who in the temple was instructing the teachers. A 12-year-old who grew up to be a 30-year-old man who wandered around as a prophet. But his power was not in his clothing or in the fact that people liked him, but in the message he brought, the message of salvation. All wrapped up in a man. Kind of the same way that we receive God's power. At baptism, wrapped up in water, the word of God comes to us and we receive the power of the Holy Spirit, the forgiveness of sins. In the Lord's Supper, wrapped up in bread and wine, the body and blood comes to us, the forgiveness of sins. In the words of our prayers, wrapped up in our fears and all those things that are on our hearts, our stress and our concerns. We know our Lord comes to us in the words of comfort of a good friend, a close loved one, sometimes bringing peace right to our hearts. That's one of the joys of Christmas, isn't it? Unwrapping all the presents. Unwrapping those things. But part of it is what is hidden first. Most of you are parents, I think. All of you are parents. And maybe you did this. I know my parents did it. Carla's parents did it. But did you all hide the presents before Christmas? I hid them before they could be wrapped up. I know that I would never do this, but Carla always tells about how she would search through closets and search through the garage and search everywhere to try to find where her parents had hidden the presents. And part of the joy then on Christmas was her parents being able to surprise her, finally showing her those presents that maybe she wasn't expecting. Isn't that the joy of our surprise? The joy we have in knowing the surprise that this babe in Bethlehem grew up to be salvation of the world. Truly, grace is wrapped up in power. But the power of God to forgive our sins, the power of God to cleanse, the power of God to prepare for us a place to rest with him. As we come before the manger, we know that these lights, that they can shine bright, whether they're LED or whether they're the brightest candle power out there, but they will never shine as bright as the child in the manger who shines into our hearts, not only this day, but each and every day. the child Jesus Christ, who is the power to save us, the power to redeem us, and the power one day to call each of us home to be with him. May the power of Christ dwell within you, as you know the many gifts our God gives to you this day and each and every day, because our God is present with us. He has pardoned our sins, and he has given us his power and promise. Merry Christmas to each of you. Please bow your heads with me as we turn to our Lord in prayer. Lord, we thank you that you have come into this world not as a righteous judge, as we so deserved, but instead you entered into this world to be our salvation. Help us each day to recognize your power made flesh, your power wrapped in grace, your forgiveness that comes to us. Help us each day to know your power, your love, that even in the times of trial in our lives, we know your strength and we know your mercy. Lead us always to know you, to love you as you have first loved us, and to share your love with others, that they too may know your salvation. This we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.